This is the Camp Savage Show, where we discuss all things entertainment, social media, and trending topics related to pop culture. I am your host, Donnie Savage, and this is episode 7. I told y'all we were going to move along, keeping that consistency, keeping that discipline, and I'm kicking these episodes out for you. You feel me? Make sure you hit that like button for me and subscribe to the channel, because this shit is going on. Today, we have a guest with such an impressive story that I guarantee it's going to blow you away. One of my homies, I know this guy personally, and he's extremely multifaceted, and he's killing it right now. But before we get into that, I want to share something with you guys, all right? I've turned over a new leaf within the last couple of months. I don't complain anymore. I had an epiphany, actually. With this epiphany, it has prompted me to completely let go of my anxiety and my stress. That tends to come with not knowing the outcome or not being able to control the outcome. Now, I live freely. I'm able to express myself freely. I'm able to create content that I've only dreamed of, and that's what I'm doing with the Camp Savage Show. You feel me? Now, my goal is to execute every single chance I get. That's from top to bottom. This is something that I look forward to doing every single day. And I'm happy to do that. I see you guys are receptive to it. And it's taken me a long time to get to this point, you know. But you have to start somewhere, right? That's the beauty of it. There's a lot of noise in the game. You can find yourself seamlessly scrolling through a bunch of different profiles, whatever pops up in your feed, and you get hooked on it. Not saying anything is wrong with it. Just take it for inspiration and keep it moving. Do not get caught up paying attention to what everybody else has going on, because it spills into your own. The objective is to stay in your lane. That's something that's very important, and that's something that we're going to touch on later when we bring our guests. Now, when I say pick a lane, that can mean a multitude of things. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to stay within one niche. As a creative and as a content creator, if you have multiple interests, as long as you're willing to stay disciplined, and you keep that consistency going with touching on each and every interest and creating content around them, I think you'll be fine. It's the times where we may post a video here and there and you never get any traction behind it. But if it's gaming, if it's basketball, if it's food content, you can do it all. Just know that you need to have a format for it and you need to stick to it. And I'm sure you'll be fine when it comes to building the traction. Will it guarantee you views? No. Will it guarantee you success? I can't do that for you. But as long as you have the willingness to look stupid, that's something that you have to figure out along the way. That's that part of not giving a fuck about what anybody thinks about you. You just doing your own thing. As long as you're equipped with that, I think as a creative or just anything you pursue, I think you'll be fine. Take it from me. Now, this leads me to my next point. Things tend to happen when you least expect it. And I got an example for you. I auditioned for a commercial job maybe 2 to 3 weeks ago. And because I have a day job, I had a conflicting schedule with a callback time. So I wasn't able to do my callback when everybody else was available to do theirs. And I don't know if the casting director ended up switching callback dates altogether. I have no idea, so don't quote me on this. But I was able to show up in person the other day. In-person callback auditions are somewhat a thing of the past since we have Zoom and we have all these online platforms. But it felt good to go showcase my work in front of a casting director and just to be able to perform, you know what I mean? It's a completely different ballgame from Zoom and an in-person audition or callback. They are not the same. So I do what I always do. Anytime that I'm working artistically as a creative, I take a gummy. It's part of my ritual. I take a gummy and I let it hit me and I just let it fly. Whatever happens, happens. Mind you, I'm always in control. I'm never veering off. It's just a part of my lifestyle, you know. I'm not telling you what to do. But I go to the callback audition. I'm on the moon. I'm not going to tell you the name of the brand. I got to keep these things under wraps, but it's an audition where I have to have a fake family. We're washing a car outside. We're having fun. The neighbors taking pictures of us. That kind of dynamic. With that being said, I got to say this. I admire child actors and kids that are able to turn that switch on and turn it off instantly. It's a hell of a skill set, Because if you can teach a kid how to be a performer and you put your game face on, and then when you're done with your work, you can go back to being a kid, it's a beautiful thing. And I was surrounded by these child actors who had bubbly personalities that can just, they just had it, you know? So I get to the audition, I walk in, sign in, I say hi to everybody. I'm meeting the parents, I'm meeting the kids, and I get assigned my fake family from the jump. So I'm talking to this mom and her son. Cute kid, I'm not gonna say his name, but cute kid, curly hair, bubbly personality. He's just full of energy and full of life, man. And what's so dope about child actors is they're just free. They're free from the jump. They don't have all these constraints with politics and race and all this other shit. Doesn't mean anything. They can just literally be kids, but they can turn that switch on and off to be able to perform. So we're just vibing out. I'm asking them a ton of questions. You know, what's your favorite color? What's your favorite sport? Do you play video games? He's asking me what my favorite food is. Italian, you know. We're just vibing out. The moment, you know, we really clicked. I'm like, all right, this is going to be my fake son. This is going to be a breeze on camera. The casting director let us know, hey, we are switching gears and we're switching families. So she was like, Donnie, you got to go with such and such. And he talking to the kid, hey, you're going to go with, I think one of the guys' names, one of the other dad's names was Elijah or something. Like, hey, you got to go with Elijah. So I'm like, damn, I just met this kid. We just clicked like this. It should be perfect. Finally happens to where it's time for our audition. Gummy smacks me in the face. So I'm smiling. I'm extra friendly. I'm cheesing. This is the perfect time for this to kick in. And we just casually washed the car as a family unit and had some fun. And the kid, our fake son, was supposed to spray us with the water hose, and me and the fake mom were laughing and shit. It was a cool little vibe. Come to find out, I got an availability check. Now, availability check is you're damn near down to the wire of who they're going to select for the job. And they're checking your availability to see if you're even available for the dates in which, you know, you shoot. Absolutely, I'm available. But I say all that to say this. I just kind of went in there with no expectations, just to have fun, bring the youthfulness to the audition. You know, just kind of just check out, do my thing, and bounce. And boom, there you go. Did I get the job? It's not set in stone yet, but we'll see. I told you I had a special guest for you. It is time to bring that special guest on. But before I bring him on here, I got to get this person their flowers because they had a hell of a bio. I'm scrolling through the bio like, get the fuck out of here. Get the fuck out of here. You did this. You work with this person. You did this. You did this. You traveled here. That's insane. I gotta go ahead and edify my boy. He is an eclectic DJ and devoted father. This LA-based musician and DJ, renowned for his musical taste, and as the go-to open format DJ in Los Angeles, he's also a dedicated father. He's a hell of a father. His talents extend to film, consulting for Sofia Coppola, curating soundtracks for Project X. You're around my age, you're 31, you know what time it is with Project X. Epic movie. Currently he's making waves in music production, with a successful house music project alongside Brody Jenner, which garnered 1 million streams with their first two singles. Now, the most important part about this is he's done all these amazing things while, number one, being an amazing father. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, welcome my dog, DJ Devin Lucien, to the Camp Savage Show. And we are going to sip to that. I know it's kind of early, but McAllen has blessed us with the McAllen 15 Highland Single Malt Scotch Whiskey. This is from the Color Collection. It's smooth. It's strong. This is a slow sipper. Do not get out of line and don't overdo it. But thank you, McAllen. Cheers to myself. Shout out to my guy for pulling up. Woo! Ladies and gentlemen, welcome my dog to the show, Devin Lucien. Excuse me, DJ Devin Lucien. I had to make that official.
Yeah.
My guy, thank you so much. I will say, of course, my pleasure. Eventually, you know, when I have a studio setting, something more official, but we're gonna rock out online for now. It's all good.
Yeah, all good. Happy to be here.
Thank you so much, man. Are you feeling on this Thursday? I know you mentioned you had a busy schedule, keeping things moving.
Yeah. It's part of my nature. I always have to like stay busy and stuff. It's difficult for me to like sit around and relax, even though it's much needed sometimes.
Completely understand, man. Especially in this content space, and you are a busy guy for one. I gotta let you know, I'm living vicariously through you. Always tune into your stories. It always looks epic.
Yeah. Sometimes.
Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead. I was gonna say, you know, like social media, a lot of times things look more epic than they actually are. You know, we always put our best foot forward on social media. I think, you know, I probably should do a better job of like letting people in on like everything that goes into it. So you can really see, like, you know, it's not always all fun, but you know, we always do put our best foot forward. So
I feel that, because even in the club setting, there's times where you see a bunch of people, it looks like they're having fun. I'm not saying your set, but just in general in clubs.
Right.
Like everybody gives you the illusion that they're having fun, but everybody's phone is in their face. They sit, it's six people staring down at the screen with a drink in their hand, not doing whack for the most part.
Right. Yeah. I think the whole culture of, you know, cause I was born in the 80s, grew up in the 90s, and you know, I started going out when I was super young, and seeing the way that things have changed with cell phones and social media and everything. I think it really used to be a totally different vibe in the club than it is now. And used to be a lot more fun, but you know, people are still having fun here and there.
So like, do you see a significant difference between the lounges, like the lounges that are supposed to be more chilled? You'll see a ton of actual, you know, sections in there versus the club experience, or is it relatively the same?
I would say like lately I've noticed that people are kind of leaning more into like the lounge vibe, and that kind of atmosphere is kind of picked up a lot more than it used to be. I think like the whole concept of being able to go to dinner and then just catch a vibe and hang out and listen to music afterwards, as opposed to being, you know, in a club with lighting and bottle service, being confined to like a section, you know, I think is like the economy has changed, and people aren't making, you know, a lot of people aren't making the money that they used to, especially young people with, you know, the Bitcoins and everything. People aren't spending like they used to. So the club culture, I think, is hurting a little bit as far as money. They're not making the money that they were when all these people who had never had money were just coming out and spending every night. So I think I've noticed like a change where the lounge vibe has become more of like the thing that people want to do, as opposed to going to clubs and stuff.
That's a bit, because I've noticed the same situation, and myself being 31, I'm like, the club scene used to be dope as far as the old culture. Obviously, like your sets look lit, like people are actually having fun, they're enjoying themselves, especially with the music that you play.
Right.
I'm finding that, and not to put a damper on hip hop, but I gotta call a spade, when it comes to the lounges and the clubs that predominantly play the music, sometimes you'll sit in a club, or you know, you're standing in a corner, you feel depressed
at
the music that they're playing, you know?
Yeah.
Especially with the drill element, no shade. You know, we were young once. It was gangster rap. It was the whole nine. So this is just, you know, the wheel is revolving. But now
I've noticed that really like the music kind of, it's almost tends to be the opposite of what's going on in society. Like there was a big, you know, during 2008, during the market crash, there was like a big resurgence of like house music. And even all the rappers were doing, you know, like house infused, almost like pop. You know, there were big records from like guys like Pitbull and everything was like using remixes of house songs. And it's almost like when the economy is down, the music's faster and happier, and people want that happier vibe, as opposed to like when the economy was doing really well, it was like a lot of slow hip hop and a lot of the SoundCloud rappers kind of blew up, and the music was, at the 70 BPM instead of 128 BPM, which is weird because you would think that when people have money, they would be listening to faster, more fun music. So I've noticed as the economy has kind of changed and we're like in this dip, the music, I've noticed that, being in other cities and other countries, like the house music is the next, I don't want to say it's the next thing because it's always big, but I think that in LA, New York, in these big cities, things are going to start shifting in that direction again. Everything's cyclical. It goes around, and the same trends pop up, 10 years later. So.
No, that's a great assessment, I guess, as a whole, because I never even looked at it like that as far as from an economical standpoint, playing into the vibe of what people are actually listening to and, where they would want to spend their time and their money. So that's really, breaking it down from a psychological standpoint, like that's deep. That's really.
Yeah, I mean, I've been in the game for, I mean, I'm 41 years old now, and I started DJing clubs when I was about 23. So I've seen, just all the changes, and one of the things that has always benefited me in my career was my ear and taste and kind of pushing things forward, because I've always had like, I don't know if we wanted to get into this that early, but I've always had like a longer leash to play the music that I want. Like a lot of the new DJs, like clubs expect them to come in and play the top 40 stuff and kind of just play what everybody wants to hear. But because I've been in the game for so long, I have, the club owners have a lot of trust in me to kind of push the limits and kind of do what I think is cool at the moment. So I've always been able to like look forward and push the trends that I see coming in the future. So I feel lucky that, the
So
chance to
with
get to do that.
with that being said, is that technically the 'cause I was taking notes. The go to open DJ format, is that technically what that is?
Open format DJing. Open format DJing is kind of like, you have your house electro DJs. I mean, I guess you could say you have your hip hop DJs. That's almost considered open format at this point because everybody was so heavy into hip hop. But my style of DJing has always been to like, it's kind of a mashup of everything. So you're getting hip hop, you're getting house, you're getting pop, you're getting some 80s stuff, some 90s stuff. And yeah, I guess open format is just considered kind of a blend of all, different genres of music, as opposed to just, going in there and playing 128 BPM electronic music, which is fun too, and I can do that. But I would say the skill set for open format DJing, there's a handful of us in the circuit that, are skilled in that avenue. And yeah, that's just kind of what we do. That's like what the bottle popping clubs are kind of all about, is like the open format style of DJing.
With that being said, do you know Sango? I mean, I would imagine you guys know of one another because you're in the same space. Producer, DJ.
Maybe it sounds familiar.
I know he does the Afro beats. I want to say the house music. What you just described to me from top to bottom, I would say he's like in that same realm.
It really it really is. I think what makes open format DJing also so difficult is you're put in rooms with a diverse crowd of people. So you're you're trying to play a mixture of everything to give everybody a little bit of something that they are into. You know, you're not predominantly playing for a hip hop crowd or a house crowd or an Afrobeats crowd. You know, you have everybody in one room, so you've got to dip into all of that stuff and kind of serve everybody this buffet of music, where they can, you know, feel that their tastes are being catered to and heard, you know. So if you don't have the skill set to kind of bounce around and do that, it's a difficult way to DJ for sure.
That's a bet, man. Okay. No, that's it's so interesting to hear you dissect this, because obviously there's a science to it. There's a whole formula behind what you do,
Right.
because you're very good at what you do. And that leads me
Right.
to my next point of like, where did you get your sound from? Like, what's the origin of that? Like, how take me to step one.
So I grew up in the 80s when MTV was like the thing, and I always gravitated towards watching music videos. So my parents would make me, like, you know, off the VCR would just record MTV when it was just music videos all day. So I was just exposed to a lot of music really early, and it was, you know, it was like the golden era of pop music, of like Michael Jackson, Madonna, Prince, Tears for Fears, you know, just all that stuff. So I think I was just exposed to like a very wide palette of music. So when I got into DJing, you know, I was always trying to play instruments and stuff. And when I first messed with turntables, I was like, oh, this is actually the first instrument that you can have fun playing without being good at. And I got into collecting records and, you know, got my own setup. And at that time, I was just collecting a bunch of different genres of music, which I think, you know, it kind of like, it was a good learning process of learning how to blend all these different types of music together. And I didn't, you know, there wasn't YouTube and all that, and, you know, TikTok and stuff, where you could see what other people were doing and, you know, and be like, oh, this is what DJing's about. I'm going to be an electronic and EDM DJ, or I'm going to be a hip hop DJ. You were just collecting music and figuring out a way to make it all work together, and, you know, playing stuff that you liked. And I think that, you know, a lot of us older guys, it created a skill set that a lot of the young kids don't pick up these days, because we were just consuming so many different types of music. And, you know, you're buying records, so you do a gig for a little bit of money, take that money, go to the store, spend it all on records for the next gig. But I think
Different type
that
of
whole
hustle.
experience, oh yeah, it was, you know,
Yeah.
I would do nights where I would make $50 and have a DJ gig the next night, and I would take that entire $50 and go buy more records so that I had new records for the next night. And,
Hell
you
yeah.
know, I think that way of learning to DJ just gives you a skill set that, unless you're learning that way, it's difficult to pick that up, you know? So I feel blessed that I grew up in that era of music.
It's dope to hear you say that, because especially not having the social media and YouTube, you know, the internet at your fingertips, you were forced to figure out a lane, and you're staying in your lane by default because you can't see what everybody else is doing. So what you pick up on, like you turn into a master of your skill set. And like what I'm and as I compare that to like social media, like being a content creator, sometimes it could be chaotic to the point where, you know, you're trying to find new inspiration and you fall into that trap sometimes. You paying a little too much attention to what everybody else has going on, to where you start to, you know, you start to pick up those habits and you fall off of what you were supposed to do. Like I've done that a couple times. Now I can finally say like my blinders are all the way up, and I'm just focusing on maybe one or two things, and that's it. Like I'm not gonna go be the travel influencer. I don't have the capacity to do that time. You know what I mean? Like I commend the people that can do that. I was inspired to do I mean, I do food content, but not to the point where like that's my whole feed and I'm in a new restaurant all day, every day. Would that be the ultimate? That would be the ultimate job for me. It's not off the list, but for me to do that right now and try to live a healthy lifestyle and stay fit, it's just not conducive to my situation. So I'm like, eventually, but I'm gonna stay in my lane, you know?
I feel you. I think I also lost out on because I'm older, my content game is not as strong as, some of these kids. And DJing has become a lot about the content game. So had I had chose to get into DJing now, where I am now in my 40s, I might not have been able to do it because I'm not, great at being on social media and creating content and making great videos and stuff. But so thankfully I did get in when I did, and I don't rely on my social media for my music career, because it'd be a struggle for me for sure.
And that's a cheat code in itself to like actually, really be a successful DJ, a successful musician versus the persona you're trying to build on Instagram or YouTube to project that. You know what I mean? Like you, because you got to earn your stripes at some point in time, and that's what I see a lot of people are trying to skip. They're trying to skip the process and just be the finished product and be polished. But you're skipping too many steps in between, and it doesn't work that way. Because at some point in time, it's gonna come crashing down, or people can poke holes in your shit, you know?
Especially with music, I feel like, it's it, it gets to a point where you gotta actually put up or shut up. It's you can only rely on social media for that kind of stuff for so long. Like, it can get you in the door, but is it going to get people to book you again if you don't know what you're doing,
Exactly. I totally agree with that. I was I like to do my recon, and there was a video. Hope I don't think this is copywritten, but it's a video, you, Brody, doing your thing. And I was showing my girl this last night. I thought it was so dope. Let me s I'm gonna switch this screen real quick. Like this video looks so epic. It was compelling. I was drawn in. I was like, I wish I was there. I'm gonna play this from the jump. Like I think this type of promo is so f-ing dope. I just want to show the people because you guys are really doing this. There's no facade.
How you feeling today, bro?
I'm feeling great today. It's almost Halloween. Shit, I got my Halloween costume right now.
This flies.
I know what I am right now.
Oh, that was in Arizona, I think.
Okay. Look at him. Okay.
I don't even know if I've seen this video.
Oh, straight up. It's dope. It's a dope video.
It is well done.
That's tough. That's tough. I just wanted to bring that up because I'm like, I mean, obviously the video is so well put together to show, show people a good time, but you guys are genuinely having fun. You guys are good friends. I want to dive into because you were solo at one point in time, correct?
Yeah, I still am solo, half the time. So yeah, a
like
lot of the
how
time
did
I'm still doing.
how did you and Brody like come together as a unit and just like leverage and scale? How did that happen?
So he had been DJing. He had been starting to DJ like in clubs. And him and another friend of mine had, recently gotten a residency in in Vegas with the Tao group, so doing like Tao and Marquee and all those nightclubs, which, you know, getting, you know, just getting into doing clubs and being put on a stage like that is a very difficult thing. Like it takes years to learn how to DJ in Vegas. It's a very particular style of DJing. And, you know, they had been having like a little bit of trouble. So him and his manager reached out to me to kind of, you know, to see if I was interested in working with Brody. And and me and Brody had known each other through like mutual friends, but we hadn't really like spent a ton of time together. It's been more of like, you know, like, hey, what's up, and in passing, or being in the same room or same group of people. So they reached out to me, and me and Brody just kind of hit it off. We started doing a couple gigs together, and it just kind of snowballed into like a thing where we started working on the road and traveling every weekend and just doing a bunch of gigs and getting, you know, residencies in Vegas, Atlantic City, Miami, New York, just kind of all over the place. And you know, we started taking it a little bit more serious. And yeah, and that was like about 7 years ago now. So,
oh, wow. Damn.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I had been working in clubs for, you know, probably, you know, 10, I don't even know at this point. It's so hard to keep track, but probably 12 or 13 years. So I'd done my rounds of like, you know, going into Vegas and bombing and having terrible sets there and kind of learning what works and what doesn't there and how to play the room. So I was able to kind of help him, you know, learn what style of music, what music was going to work in those situations. And, you know, what always like excited me about him is like, he was always, even though he had, you know, the fame aspect and could have just been like, oh, I'll just show up and people are going to come see me because of my name. Like he genuinely wanted to learn how to do it the right way. And was like eager to learn and put in work and get better. And, you know, it's been a mutually beneficial relationship in terms of business. And, you know, through the years we've become great friends and have traveled the world and, you know, had a lot of great times. And, you know, now I consider him, you know, one of my best friends. So it's worked out and we're still going 7 years later. So.
That is a hell of a partnership. I love that. I love that because it's the fact that both of you guys see leverage, you know?
Right.
That, and it's like, even in a social media game, you see some people, like, they have a standalone brand and they only do their own thing. I mean, for whatever reason.
Right.
But it's like when you can work with like-minded people and you see the bigger picture and you can take it to another moon, you can still do your solo thing. There's nothing wrong with that. But if you can use that leverage and make a bag and it's somebody you rock with, that's why like collaboration is so important. Like I'm big on that. I'm big on collaboration and relationships and scaling, you know? So like that's
right.
That is a beautiful example of that. That's dope. Congrats, by the way. You guys have been doing your thing.
Yeah. Yeah. I, you know, I'm always down to try new things in terms of my career, you know, like you learn to, you have to evolve, no matter what you're doing. So for me to get stagnant and think that, you know, just doing the same thing with my career that I've been doing for years is going to continue to work is naive, because you know you don't know where you're, you know. I think COVID has taught that to a lot of us, that we don't know that you know, tomorrow it can all disappear. You know, I didn't work for a year and a half, so I think, you know, being able to have a different project where I can be branded in this particular way and still have my other solo stuff and have that brand going for me. It's like, why would you not want to have multiple avenues and multiple brands that you can do different things and tap into different markets. You know, it only makes sense for yourself.
Facts. That is facts, man. And again, congrats on that.
Yeah,
I tune into everything you're doing, man. Look, I'm a fan. I have no problem saying
likewise,
that. You know
man,
what I mean?
Likewise.
I appreciate that. Definitely want to give you your flowers, bro. Hell of a father, by the way. That's one of the, like, for me, and, you know, and we've talked offline. You know what I mean? Not to dive into that entirely, but I always commend you for being a dope father before anything. You know, like, you're a hell of a DJ. I see you and your son. The bond you have is amazing. I just wanted to mention that.
Yeah, that's the number one job right there, right?
Hell yeah.
I feel very lucky for that bond and that connection. So yeah.
Look,
it's
man,
easy
you got,
to be
you got
a good
cool
dad
ass
when
kid.
When you got that love. Oh yeah, he's a great soul. Very, very proud of him.
Hell yeah. Look. Moving forward. And like when you sent me your bio, I was blown away. I was fucking blown away. I saw a soundtrack on the list from a project, Project X.
Whack.
Epic film. You know, I remember when it came out. I was like, I think I may have been my first second year of college, and that's at that time frame where you wish you can go to big ass parties like that. You know what I mean? Like epic, insane parties where everything goes left. So I'm very, very familiar. Like, how did you become a part of that process, man? I mean, being involved with the soundtrack, because that's fucking dope.
So at the time, one of the producers of the movie, Scott Budnick, he was Todd Phillips. He worked with Todd Phillips at the time. I think he was like Todd Phillips, like right-hand guy. And he used to come out in LA a bunch, and we became friends through that. There was a club back at that time called Voyeur, which is where Delilah is. 796 on Santa Monica. So that space used to be this place called Voyeur, which was like an amazing club. And I used to do, I think it was a Thursday night party there. So I used to see him all the time and got intro'd to him. So when they were coming up with the concept to this movie, he reached out to me personally and was like, would you like to come on board as a music consultant for this? And help us with, you know, putting together like the DJ scenes and make sure that it's an authentic vibe for the movie, because we want it to feel as real as possible. And they had also connected me with the music supervisor, which is this guy, Gabe Hilfer, who's now one of the most successful music supervisors in the business. Like, does all these amazing shows with it, tremendous music, has tremendous taste, great, you know, was great person to work with in terms of like learning and seeing what they do. So they brought me in. He hit me up and he's like, yeah, we got a meeting at Warner Brothers. So I'm like on the lot at Warner Brothers, and I was young at the time. I think I was probably, when I say young, I was probably like mid-20s or something. Okay. And you know, I show up to this meeting at Warner Brothers and I'm like, what the fuck? You know, like, how am I on the slot going to this meeting? Like, this is crazy. And I remember I had taken some notes of like songs that were at the time for me in the club world were what, like, well-known songs, but for everybody else out there, like, might not have been, you know, they weren't hits yet by any means. And I remember writing down on that pad, it was, you know, the Heads Will Roll A-Track remix and Kid Cudi, Pursuit of Happiness, Steve Aoki remix. The first day I came in with those two songs, and I was like, no matter what we do, these two songs are going to be, you know, they're they're already big, but they're going to be massive songs. And these are the party songs of the moment that you guys like need to be aware of. So it was like on that first day, those two songs that I brought in ended up being kind of like the staples of the movie. I would say Pursuit of Happiness, and they're you know, they're used during the most epic parts of the movie. And I think even like the trailer, and you know, it, I would say that being in that movie like kind of blew up Kid Cudi in like the pop sense, and kind of put him on the map with a lot of people who didn't know who Kid Cudi was. So to be a part of like that, of bringing, you know, an artist like that to the table at Warner Brothers, and having it play any sort of role in like the popularity of that song or whatever, was just such a cool experience. And to be on set and see them, you know, putting the movie together. And I got to film a couple scenes. And like, if you look, I'm like in the background of a couple of the DJ scenes and stuff. It was just a cool learning experience. And cool,
I gotta to go see back it all come together.
Yeah. Yeah. There's like an indoor, the indoor party scene where the kid like flies through the window with a skateboard. If you look, it's like me DJing and you can see my laptop in the background with my name and stuff. So it was, it was pretty cool for a young kid to be a part of something like that, for sure.
That's so crazy, because everything you just said, like, that's because we always associate songs with films, and that's
right.
Literally the song, when I think of that movie, that's the only song that comes to mind.
Yeah, pretty
especially
crazy,
for
right?
the slow motion parts, and because they had that slow motion element in the music video. You know, I remember the trailer. Yeah. I remember all that vividly, and to hear that you had a hand in that is crazy. That blows my mind.
Yeah, for on the first day, I remember the first day I was carrying that notepad, and it was like, for whatever reason, I just knew that those songs, you know, because they'd given me the script, and I read the script, and I was just like, these are the songs. And it's just so cool that I can look back and be like, oh wow, you had the foresight to know that those two songs would be play a major role in that movie. And yeah, just like looking back on it, it's just such a cool experience that I got to do something like that.
Damn, I'm just sitting here revisiting childhood and just thinking about that, and knowing that you helped put that together is crazy. Because yes, you know, we pay attention to films, but the soundtrack is what makes the film. It's the score, you know, when certain things, you get the climax of the movie, or you know something bad is going to happen, or it's some smooth ass dudes walking to the scene, and then they got to have the theme music, you know, like all that comes together to make up the masterpiece. And that's what cool.
Yeah. And it was the soundtrack ended up being number one on iTunes for a few weeks, I think, which was cool to see that.
That's what's up. Hell yeah.
Yeah, it's funny. My girlfriend is 28 years old. And, it, you know, she's like around the similar age as you, a little younger. So she, you know, Project X for her was like a huge deal. And she had been obsessed with the movie. And like, we had already been dating for a couple of years. And like, we were somehow, it came up in conversation. I was like, oh yeah, I worked on that movie and did that. And she was like, what? Like, I love that movie. And we ended, and I hadn't seen it in like, I mean, I hadn't seen it in years, and we watched it together, and I was like, wow, this is like a trip down memory lane seeing this. And she was just like, you worked on this when you were in your 20s? Like, what? That's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of those films, I mean, especially for that age range, everybody knows. Like, even if you didn't watch the movie, you're at least familiar with it. Like, oh yeah, Project X, yeah, I know what you're talking about. Like,
yeah, even the cover of the movie was like so memorable, of the kid like laying in the grass. And I don't know if you know the rapper Ken Carson, but his one of his like early albums is like a picture of him laying on the grass. And it's just like, wow, that's crazy. That movie influenced so many like generations of people, you know, that are now like grown and putting out music, and it's like still having an influence on them. So cool to be a part of.
Hell yeah. All right. I want to move on to some high profile clients because, like I said, man, every part of your bio, I was just like, what the fuck? Like, bro, how did you find all the time to do this? You know what I mean? But like, just, if you can give some insight on some of like the high profile clients you DJed for, because I see that you DJed for like high profile weddings. I know you did you headline Coachella or did you?
I played. So every year, like the H-Wood group, you know, they own Bootsy's, Poppy, Delilah, Nice Guy. They throw a party out there. Brothers? That is no. That's John Turgeon and Brian Toll, who I've known for years. I was like one of their first DJs when they opened their first spots. Was doing parties for them. So we've been working together for since I was probably like for at least 15 years or so. But they do a party every year. Shit, I want to say it's Nylon, but it's not Nylon. I forget the name. It's like it's a big online clothing brand. God, I'm so useless with these names that just all blends together. But they do a big party every year out at Coachella. And so I've, you know, been lucky enough to play that for a number of years. But yeah, it's just one of like the major parties that's like, you know, after party or before party or whatever. So one of these days, hopefully I'll get to play Coachella. That would be an experience, but haven't got to do that yet.
At this point, bro, I don't see why they don't have you on there already. Like that is mind blowing to me. And speaking of the festivals, I went for the first time last year. I did not realize how exhausting that was. Like I was mentally drained. I mean, it was a good thing that I had a collaboration with Smirnoff, so you know, I'm at their activation booth, getting content for them. They were gracious enough to pay me my fee and put me in a resort. And I got to bring my girl and my dog. I appreciate y'all for that. So I'm not complaining about that. I just, the amount of people that are out there is insane. I didn't know it got that cold in the desert at night. I had a vest on. I was about to lose my mind. the sandstorms. That was crazy. Don't get me wrong. It was an experience. Like I would definitely suggest, if you make it out to the West Coast or if you're on the West Coast, at least check it out one time. You know, it's a hell of an experience. But just make sure you got your shit together before you go out there. All that sleeping in tents and that's not a thing. Don't let anybody
lie. It's crazy to see how much it's changed through the years. I went to the second Coachella. I think I was 18 years old. So I went to the second one, and I've pretty much gone to every Coachella with the exception of like maybe three of them through the years. So to like see the evolution of what it's become now is pretty phenomenal. And like, you know, as trendy as it gets, and you know, people want to say that, you know, like, oh, fuck Coachella, it's this, it's that, it's whatever. Like, yeah, it has become those things, but also you can't go to a place like that, a beautiful place like that, and see that kind of music over a 3-day period. Like there's no other experience like that. And, you know, as much as you want to be on it, it's still an amazing place to go see live music and experience, you know, immerse yourself in music. So.
Oh, that's facts. I went to Neon Carnival. That was crazy. Thank God I had VIP to everything. We were in the Don Julio VIP section. You're just throwing back tequilas. The crazy part is celebrities were fairly accessible. You know what I mean? It was like if you wanted to be in the place to be for that weekend, you can walk around the lot and at any given time just run into somebody randomly. Paris Hilton, Brent Faiyaz. Jared Leto was just cruising through doing his thing by himself. You know, it was definitely an epic place to be.
Yeah, that's shout out to Don Julio, by the way. They turn a great event. They do that every year. I DJed the first Neon Carnival, the first couple Neon Carnivals actually. Which another party that's like evolved and turned into a whole different beast. The whole weekend is amazing, you know, and I think this past year I kind of learned I didn't DJ any parties, and it was, I think I've kind of like learned that like I don't need to work everywhere that I go, like I, just because I'm out at some, you know, at a festival or concert or whatever, like I don't feel obligated in the same way I used to have to fill my schedule with like work. And it was nice to just enjoy being with my friends and like barbecuing at the house and not feeling like I had to go like rush and play a party and, you know, miss out on spending time with like, you know, my friends, which every year I've like forced myself to like work all this stuff. And it was the first year that I kind of sat back and just like enjoyed it. And it was, you know, I think the older I get, the more I'm like realizing that, like, you know, it's not always about like, you know, what you're doing. It's about who you're with, you know, that kind of makes the experience the most, you know, rich for me, at least.
No, I can coin that as well. Because everything in life is just about moments at the end of the day, right, man. Just, it was like when I lost my pops, I could just think about memories and moments, because like that's the only thing that matters at this point. The arguments don't matter, you know. The petty doesn't matter. It's literally about the good times, and that's what plays back in my mind over and over and over again. You know, I had those good moments, so it's like, look,
right.
For those viewing this, and man, you just kind of wrapped up in the rat race, like you're focused on what you got going on. It's cool. Stay focused, buckle down. But you need to get out here and enjoy time with your friends, your family, the hobbies you enjoy doing. Do that to the fullest. Whatever you're into, like, take it to the heights, because we don't borrow time. It's a real thing when, I mean, obviously we all have some type of form of trauma that we go through, whether it's death, whatever the case may be, but it changes you to go, you know, you may go left, you may go right. I chose to take the high road and just kind of go along and figure it out as I went, you know, for the most part. Like I don't have the answers to this. Just, I wanted to pour more into the things that I enjoy doing, which is content creation. I'm a gym rat. It brought my dog. We're probably more close now than we've ever been, because she was there in that moment for me, you know.
Right.
Those are the things that matter. But like, not to put a damper on the situation, I just wanted to throw that in.
Yeah, I, you know,
it's important.
I think it's very insightful. You know, your outlook on that, because I think in our most difficult times is like when we learn the most about ourselves and are forced to kind of learn the most about ourselves and dig deeper into what's making us tick, what's making us feel the way that we're feeling, what's important to us. And, you know, I bring up COVID again, because for me, like a lot of things happened in my life, like not working, you know, going through a divorce and started a separation during that time. And, you know, thankfully I've come out on the other side and better friends with my ex than I ever was, and are doing the co-parenting successfully. But I think, like, you know, going through that dark time, like it took me to a place where I was forced to kind of like look at my own and my own insecurities and resentments and, you know, dig deeper and it, you know, had I not gone through a hard time, I don't think I would have ever taken the opportunity to like take a look at myself and try to get to the root of, you know, the things that make me tick and why I acted the reason, ways that I did and felt the way that I did. And, you know, I think as hard as these times are, like you can either let it bring you down and, you know, do negative for you, or you can try to get something good out of it. So, you know, I think absolutely, it's very insightful that you're able to do that. And to commend you on that.
Thank you. And I kind of, the people that have been tuning in, I know I kind of touch on this a little bit every show, but the reason behind it is I wouldn't be doing it if that didn't happen. That's just the honest to God truth.
Right.
It just kind of awakened some type of level of I give no facts. I'm going to do exactly what I say I'm going to do. You know what I mean? It's something I've been kind of mentally in the works, you know, for a long time. But I'm like, I need to do this and bring this to life. Like I know a lot of amazing people, including yourself. You know what I mean? Like I had a format for this where I wanted to bring on just solid people. I don't give a fuck about how huge you are on TikTok or the, you know, the viewership or how many subscribers you got on YouTube. Like, yeah, that's cool, but I'm only bringing people on that I know personally, you know, for the most part. I mean, we'll branch out eventually, right? But nah, like I want to start this foundation solid, you know, like none of the fluky weird vibes.
Right. Well, I'm glad to be part of the early stages of it.
Not like, it means the world to me that you even say yes to come on here, bro. Honestly.
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's like what we were talking about earlier. It's like you want to collaborate with people that you like, you know. It's you, if you can't support friends and do stuff with your friends, it's like what are we really doing, you know? So you know, it's I think we're all working towards the same thing and trying to hustle and be successful and be good people and be part of cool things. So yeah, it's my pleasure to be a part of something like this.
My man. I just have one more topic for you, man. And it's quick. I'll let you go. Being that you're extremely seasoned and polished in your field at this point, and I know it's a different climate for DJs and just up and coming DJs now.
Yep.
What kind of advice would you give an up and coming DJ or somebody that wants to be in the music space, and especially if they do have leverage with social media? I mean, obviously you have to start somewhere. But I've just noticed a lot of creators that weren't DJs before just started to dabble in different things. Not to, like, they're just DJs all of a sudden, which, hey, to each his own. You know what I mean? Like it is what it is. I'm trying to figure out like how do you earn your stripes in this space now? You know what I mean? I know it's kind of like a loaded question. I was trying to formulated as I went, but
yeah, you know, that's it's had it been, you know, 10, 15 years ago, I would have had a completely different answer, because now so much is based off social media and following and you know, all that stuff plays a great part in getting you in the door now. Because there is so many people trying to become a DJ that, you know, a lot of places will just look at, oh, this person has this following, like they have a great following. Great, I'll have them come DJ. But I think, you know, the one bit of advice that I can give, the thing that's going to keep you working and continue to get gigs and have people have you back and give you, you know, some long-term success in DJing is, you know, you've got to figure out what you do best with DJing, like what your special talent is with DJing, because we all do something different up there. Even though we might be playing the same records and all sort of pulling from the same music. It's like, how do you play these records? Some people are technically gifted and scratching and cutting and doing all that stuff. And, there's always going to be somebody out there that's better at doing that. For me, I always found that like my taste level and ability to like read a room and play for the room and be able to see what worked best in a room was always my greatest talent. So that's kind of what I've always focused on, was having, perfecting my taste and ability to do what I thought that I did best. So I would say like the biggest thing with DJing is like you got to find what makes you special, how you play these records, what kind of story you're telling with the music, and like take some pride in kind of creating, a brand that's based around the things that you do best, instead of just doing what you think DJing is supposed to be and what you're seeing as popular. Like, what's popular is always going to change. So you got to stay true to yourself and do what you do, and do the things that you like and play the music that you like, because it's going to be much easier for you to be successful if you stay true to what you love to do, instead of just doing what you think the next trend is. So I would say that's the one piece of advice I could give.
That was
A little
well
long-winded,
put.
but
No, 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 no. No, it's perfect, because that's applicable to like all things. Because,
Right.
in the social media space, obviously, there's trends. Trends are cool for, I would say, for the sake of viewership, to get noticed, but it's not necessarily on brand and authentic to your brand if it's just based on trends. Like, you have to find your thing, whatever works for you.
Right.
Yeah, it's applicable to all things. Like, that's advice that's universal. That's why I think it's so dope.
Yeah, it's interesting that you say that it is applicable for everything, because like if you're, I think a good comparison is like if you're a chef, you're I'm sure you can go in there and, if you're a great chef, you can cook Mexican food, sushi, Italian food. But if you look at any great chef, like there's Hiro and he's a sushi chef. There's Italian chefs. Like you got to figure out what you like to do, what tastes good to you. Like what's your specialty? And you got to kind of like, as fun as it is to cook everything and, oh, sushi's popular right now, I'm gonna do sushi. Like if it's not what you do, then eventually somebody's gonna figure out that that's not what you do. So
Yes. Moral of the
take that
story.
advice and apply it to whatever your passion is, I guess.
Stay in your lane. Stay in your lane. Stay in your lane, yo. But look, man, hey, thank you so much
Yeah, of
pulling up to the
course,
Camp
anytime.
Savage show, man. This is probably one of my favorite. I'm not gonna call it interview, because it's way more lax than an interview. It's just a conversation at the end of the day. And shout out to my boy Q the Boss. He really inspired me to do this. He had me on his podcast maybe a month ago, 2 months ago, and I love this format. I love the fact that it was just a conversation. There was nothing hardcore, like pretentious. Like we're like, I got you on CNN or something. You know what I mean? It's none of that. It's just way more relaxed. I don't care if you rolled one, if that's what you wanted to do. Cool. Whatever you want to do, be authentic to yourself. That's the whole premise of this. But where can people find you on social media? Look, you got to plug your social media in for sure.
So everything is just at Devin Lucien, no DJ in it, just at Devin Lucien on Instagram, TikTok, Twitter, X, whatever it's called. People are still using that. But yeah, everything's at Devin Lucien.
Hell yeah. Hey, well, you heard it from the man himself. I'm signing off. I'm Donnie Savage. Say thank you to our guest, Devin Lucien, for pulling up. Give this man a round of applause.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. Yeah.
All love, brother. I will catch you guys on the next one. You already know what time it is.